everybody, and welcome to the headline session by Dr. Heather Knight. Thank you very much for coming. It's wonderful to see another packed room again today on day three. Dr. Heather Knight is an assistant professor of robotics at Oregon State University. Her charisma research group uses methods from entertainment to bootstrap the development of social robots. Their research interests include minimal social robots, robot ethics, charismatic machines, and multi-robot, multi-human social interaction. Heather also runs the Marilyn Monrobot, a robot theater company with comedy performances and an annual robot film festival. Without much ado, I'd like you all to please give a Sugata Mitra welcome to Heather.
You forgot to introduce Ginger. Robot performers kind of need a lot of attention. So technology has changed the world. And what better embodiment of technology could there be than a robot? Robots have all the computation power of a computer or the smartphones we carry in our pocket. Except they can act on the world, and they also act on us. My name is Heather Knight. I am a professor of robotics and computer science at Oregon State University, and I have been building and programming social robots for 16 years. I'm going to tell you about that journey. So I'm going to start this presentation with somewhat of a provocative statement. I think that artists are better at using technology than engineers. It's not enough to teach people skills. We also need to teach people creativity. Why are we actually making the technology that we make? And what kind of impact do we want to have it on our lives? People are not utilitarian, and neither should robots only be utilitarian. So this talk is not about educating people. It's about people educating robots. And the reason for this is that the reason we create technology is for people. Nothing that we do with robots, with phones, with education matters if it doesn't have a human, a student, a teacher, a person at the other end of it. So outside of my research lab, Charisma, I also run a robot film festival. So I'm going to splice different videos throughout the talk to help illustrate some of the potentials that I believe there are for robots in our everyday lives. So I'm going to start with a film called Chorbot, which was one of our first Robot Film Festival films.
Sir.
Do you know people like this?
Charging. The train arrives in 10 minutes. Simon, time to play ball.
I think this is a future we don't want.
Your morning coffee, sir. Charging. The train arrives in 10 minutes.
Yeah, he's not here. Everything looks all right. There's a couple of cups of cold coffee. He must have left in a hurry. Yeah, no, the front door code worked fine. All right, I'll meet you at Hoochie's.
Thank you.
I don't know. Wasn't here a month ago.
What's all this?
It looks like a reverse robbery.
The train arrives in 10 minutes.
A tour bond.
You know, this thing was not here a month ago, I swear.
A robot's been taking care of the dog the whole time.
Wow. You want to take him, or should I call animal control?
Oh, yeah, all right, I'll take her.
Simon, time to play ball. Simon, time to play ball. Simon, time to play ball. Simon, time to play ball.
That I really love about this film. One is that it shows both the limitations and the potentials of robots. That robot is not super smart, right? Keeps serving the coffee, doesn't really have a good model of the world. It only knows what we tell it it's possible to know. But we still care about it, and I get so sad at that last scene, like when you think maybe the dog wasn't. Did, how many of you thought the dog wasn't going to come back? Just a couple. All right. So, well, I don't know. I got really sad. And, you know, it just like the dog, when something takes care of us and when it helps us out, especially when other people aren't, we can bond with these machines. And it's not really about the complexity of the machine itself. It's about the complexity of being human. So I think that entertainment, maybe filmmaking, but we'll share some other aspects of entertainment, like acting, theater, performance, can help make robots that are both useful and charismatic. And the main reason why I think that they have such a good insight is that entertainment really thinks about people. So we're going to have three main sections of this talk. I'm going to start to take you on this journey of how I started working between robotics and entertainment. And then we're going to talk about the state of the field in robotics right now. And then I'm going to give you some examples of how I think entertainment can make better future robots. The mappings to education in general, I think, are going to be somewhat obvious, but I'm excited to talk to you more in the Q&A as well. So first of all, why entertainment? How many of you guys know that the word robot was invented in a play? Like, almost nobody, right? Well, so the word robot first came into use in this play, a Czech play, Rossum's Universal Robot, in the 1920s. But we have other instances of machines like automata or clockwork robots in Japan that were used for entertainment purposes. And, of course, robots are Hollywood darlings. R2-D2, Rosie the Robot, WALL-E, Johnny Five, there are so many. Can any of you guess what the ones I've listed have in common? They're all in the movies, but any characteristic? Are they nice robots or evil robots? Yeah, so they're all very friendly, nice robots. It's not just the Terminator, guys. Let's brainwash the future with positive storytelling about robots. All right, but so how did I personally come to entertainment? So when I started, I was studying electrical engineering as an undergrad, and I had the opportunity to do an internship on an on-campus lab in social robotics. So I worked with Cynthia Brazil, who kind of founded this field of thinking about how robots could relate to people by borrowing some of the ways that we already communicate with each other. So I've had a chance to help build robots, and including some electronics and sensors for this robot 8 years ago, which it was created by Aldebaran Robotics, which is now SoftBank owned, and you'll get to meet at the end of this talk. So I did do some work in space instrumentation, and it was all very cool, but it was very far from home. And I missed the part where I could see people walk in a room and not have anything be explained and know how to interact with a robotic system. And I'm going to show you an example of that now. So I thought I was just building robots, but when I look back at some of my early work, it really seems a lot more like artwork. So I'm going to show you an example of that right now. This is Cyberflora. This is my first real robotics project. Flowers, there are four kinds, had, you can leave the music on, have pretty simple behavior systems. So one thing that's really important to people is that we pay attention. Can you please, yeah, the music is good. So doing things like just responding when people start to interact or tracking people as they go around the room is already starting to touch on some interesting components of what matters to us. And it doesn't need to be explained. If you walk in a room and someone looks up at you, we are all highly aware of that because the way we moderate interaction with each other is through these kinds of communications. But you also want to add some complexity. So, for example, the copper flower that's kind of in the back of the frame right now, it would try to equalize the signal between its petals. It would look for kind of warm objects. That's us. And so it would track you around the room. But if you got too close, it would also get afraid. So this idea of doing something that simple, but where someone has to work for it, or the robot has some kind of complexity, creates kind of some complex storytelling, but that didn't require any explanation for people. Theater is also very art-like, but it actually has a timeline. So you see depictions of relationships developing over time, like the dog with the robot. Was moving more into theater and robotics, the biggest point of inspiration for me was the work that I did while I was at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory in my free time with SynLab. So we built interactive art installations for events in Los Angeles, and we had a lot of fun. And OK Go, which is a band that makes really fun music videos, was looking for some people to build a Rube Goldberg machine. So we put a pitch together. A lot of people were involved, but 12 main people were leading the project, and we built this video. And I'm going to share some insights with you afterwards about how integral the performers were to making a machine that had human value. The band gave us a couple constraints. If you didn't know what a Rube Goldberg machine was before, you will in like 5 seconds. But they wanted the machine to start its own music, so it's going to start a little iPod in just a minute. They wanted to hit some major beats, to have references to their past videos, and to go from small to big. Start. Remember that tennis ball. One person spent like 6 weeks making this part. Please notice the other piano in the background. You're about to see some mousetraps. Lots of JPL people, so we had to have a Mars rover. I hope you all know what you're going to do next weekend. Make one of these in your garage. Notice the other TVs. This is where it starts getting kind of dangerous for the camera person. So let me tell you a couple stories about that video. We thought we were like basically done with the machine maybe 2 weeks before the filming was set to begin. The band came back from tour. We walked them through, and they said, you need to change this and this and this. This won't read. They won't understand the complexity. We want it to feel like anyone can do this in their own kitchen or if they just need enough time. So they had us replace about a third of everything in that machine in the last 2 weeks, blowing through every last cent of our budget. No one got paid except the camera people. They always get paid. and they were 100% right. And they're not engineers, but they know what people care about, and they were right. And at that point, I was like, oh my God, I need to get these people into my future lab, which now I have. It's pretty exciting. And get them to help me make robots that actually serve human functions. So that's what we're going to lead into. But before I tell you about the work that we're doing with entertainers, I would like to step back and talk about robotics. So the field of robotics is in transition right now, and that transition will really benefit from this kind of collaboration. In particular, robots are going away from the three Ds, the dull, the dangerous, and the dirty, and they are starting to enter into our everyday human environments. Automation is no longer the innovation in the field. The innovation is collaborative robotics, robots that can share the same hallways so we don't have to build specialized tracks on the ceilings of a hospital if we want them to deliver medical samples, and robots that interface with us for education, for entertainment, for healthcare, for helping people stay independent for longer. And that often involves a robot interfacing with one or more people. So robots that operate around people are a little bit different than traditional engineering, what has traditional engineering has taught us. They need to prioritize what people care about. And that means that if you're a computer scientist, you have probably learned that if you are trying to solve the problem of creating a path from A to B, you are looking for the most direct path, the shortest path, the fastest path. But when you throw humans into those equations, those optimization functions are going to change. In this case, they wanted a robot with flair. So sociability, which is the way that we interact directly with each other and parse information from speech to nonverbals, is the way we communicate. And it's a very efficient information exchange. I can gather a lot of data really quickly. If I'm walking down the sidewalk with a robot and I'm looking at the robot and don't see a car that's coming behind me, the robot could say, "Excuse me, Professor Knight, there is a vehicle approaching at very high velocity." Or it could say, "Watch out!" Right? And even if it didn't actually have the ability to have speech, as we saw in Chorbot at the beginning, even just those nonverbal gestures to label that information as valuable, which is how we encode information in our brain because we have emotional valence, like to help decide whether it's actually worth storing, is really important. The other thing you need to know is that people bond with machines, like in the video you saw before. I love this poster on the left. Someone lost their drone, which, you know, have their own issues, but they basically put up a reward, like they had a missing dog, and they were and they just really missed it and wanted it back. And those robots do not have to look like people. On the right, you'll see the cobot robots. These were the main robots that I worked with during my PhD thesis, autonomous mobile robots. I asked my son, Xavier, give the robot a hug. He hesitated for a microsecond, and then just like a tree. So I think that leveraging human metaphors can help make useful and charismatic machines, and I'm going to give you a bunch of examples about that in a second. So the main message here is that entertainment can teach the world a lot about making better technology. And so that's important if you're teaching the next generation of technologists, but it's also just fun if you want to give a kid a robot toy that they want to teach. There's nothing more educational than teaching. So we're putting the humans in the teacher position. So I will argue that putting robots on stage is better it makes better robots in the real world. And this is because entertainment identifies what matters to people and can also help us explore future possibilities that we don't even know yet. We can simulate the future using entertainment methods. I'm going to show you one more video from, this is from last year's Robot Film Festival. We're going into our seventh year. This is Del2. So this was a concept video created by a design student in Portugal. So again, robots don't have to look like people to be able to make use of these kinds of social communications. You have to mimic him precisely because he is very demanding. So are educational games going to get upset at you and try to go do something else if you don't respect them? I love the idea of machines having hobbies. Selfie. He has a mind of his own, but he still wants your company. All right. Again, I'm using this as an illustration of some central ideas. So the last part of the talk is split into three sections: character, storytelling, and humor. So where does our sense of a robot character come from? I'm going to start with an anecdote. So this is Ginger. I try to bring her as my carry-on when I fly because I don't want her to get hurt. When I got here, some of the staff and the organizers of the conference were asking me, how was Ginger's trip? When I went through airport security, when I first got to Hyderabad, the security agents will ask, what does she do? And I was like, She's a stand-up comedian. Does she have a name? Yeah, Ginger. And the guy's like, oh, I'm garlic. It's impossible not to anthropomorphize something that looks humanoid. But what is, let's talk about that word. So anthropomorphism is the attribution of human or creature-like characteristics onto something that is not really alive. And when does this happen? So it's kind of obvious that this is actually a robot on the left, the Actroid. If it's ultra-humanoid, for sure. If it's a calculator, probably not, but maybe some of you are up to the challenge. But then there's sometimes things in the middle. It depends on how they behave. So I'm going to show you a video of one of the projects that I'm working on right now. These are actually two of my Indian students, so I thought it would be fun to have here. This is a chairbot. So in this case, they're doing very functional, but kind of more social communication. But you could also imagine a chair that, you know, maybe you weren't very nice to it earlier and it didn't want to offer you a seat. Maybe you could have a chair at a restaurant that's also the maitre d'. It can show you to the table and itself. So when we try to distill what does the essence of character come from, one of the things that we find in people, and this is on our own heads, is that if we can observe a robot making decisions, that's when we start to think of it as having agency. So I'm not the first person to have thought about this. This idea of agency through decision-making comes from Heider and Simmel, two psychologists in the 1940s, who showed participants the following video. So you can imagine these are Roombas or something else. I'm just going to let you watch it. Think about who they are, what they want, and how simple they are. Yay. So every single person that watched this film created a story. Sometimes the stories were different. But the idea is just by watching this sequence, and in this part I don't think we should make robots do, it is part of being human to create these kinds of stories. And one of the reasons why we do create these stories is that these objects, these shapes, are following their own impulses. So if you think about the difference between an object just following the laws of physics, like a falling leaf, and one that suddenly sees a butterfly and starts chasing it, that's the difference between something that is object and something that seems alive. So how can we actually enact this into robots? To start, I'm going to just tell you a little bit about the human brain. So it turns out if you watched that video and saw a story, you have a healthy human brain. Neuroscientists have actually developed diagnostic tests for our ability to parse social behavior that are very similar to the video you just saw. If you don't see that story, then maybe we need to get some extra training to learn about social behaviors. And this happens because we have parts of our brains that are dedicated to processing biological motion. And that was really important in this sort of predator-prey thing. Like, who is the enemy? Is that person going to eat me? Are they a member of my tribe? Are they a potential sexual partner? Like, these things that we process, like, super, super fast. In the United States, we talk about job interviews being decided in the first 15 seconds. What do you think is happening in those 15 seconds? It's all of these really snap judgments about character, intent, agency that are happening really quickly. Some theorize that we have mirror neurons, sometimes called monkey see, monkey do neurons, because the people that discovered this phenomena found the researchers were basically tracking the put electrodes in the brain of the gorillas, and they were doing things like, oh, it eats a banana, and this part of the brain lights up. And then a grad student went in and ate a banana, and they hadn't unhooked the robot. They were taking a break. No, unhooked the gorilla, sorry. They were taking a break, and that same region of the gorilla's brain lit up. So people theorize that when you see something else moving, when you see a performer on stage, that we process those same motions through our own motor circuitry. And I said, oh, well, if I was driving that car, that would mean I'm being really aggressive, I'm really polite, and so on. I'll show you an example. So this is from the beginning of my thesis work. But so again, these are the cobots I showed you before. But basically, sorry, it's not playing locally. Are these moving for you? Cool. So something as simple as changing the speed of a robot moving down a hallway, and these robots were carrying baskets of candy, changed the likelihood of whether people would take candy from those robots. The one that on the left that was moving more slowly seemed accessible, like it had time. The one on the right seemed a little bit, well, maybe more intimidating because it was moving more quickly, but a lot of people also said, it looks like it has somewhere to go. I don't want to interrupt it. So India seems to be a big fan of the selfie. Like the rest of the world. And I'm sure when you imagine like talking to me after the thing, you'll parse who I'm talking to, how fast I'm moving, and so on. Like, is this a good time to ask for a selfie? So just like with people, communicating well makes robots better at their jobs and also more fun to be around. So robot motion matters. Can entertainment help? And I'm going to turn this on because it takes a couple minutes. The emoji is my reminder not to forget to turn Ginger on. So I'm going to tell you about some work I did adapting a system from theater into robotics. And we're going to do this pretty quickly. But basically, it's called the Laban Effort System. And it was developed to annotate human dancer motion. And I think that that's helpful because human actors are the only people that have tried to encode different characters that could change from a 1 week to the next in our current society. So and they've come up with systems that we can reuse. So I'm going to tell you briefly about the Laban effort system. So I like to think, I told you I started as an electrical engineer. I like to think of it as four dip switches. So you can have something, the space pole, so I can be looking at you directly. I can be looking all over the place, and that's going to indicate a different attitude towards space. And there's several other characteristics. So the ones on the left are associated with a more aggressive animal. But if you do something as simple as flipping just one of those dip switches, you change the attitude towards time from sudden to sustained, you can go from something that looks like aggression to something that looks like power and confidence. So theater basically provides spaces of motion features over which we can try to train robots to express different types of states. And so I've written a lot about this. If you want to nerd out, you can look at my publications. But I will say that one thing that we have found in this 4 or 5 year exploration of expressive motion is that bystander communication, not so much if we are, I'm already friends with you, but if we're deciding to talk for the first time or if we're just sharing a hallway, bystander communication is dominated by nonverbal communication. And I'll show you an example of that that reminds me of outside this hotel. Sorry. Ah, no, like punchline, sorry. Go. So robot motion definitely impacts the people around it. Like you can see the driver trying to make this mental model of that robot. What do I do now? Okay, I guess it stopped. I'm going to pass, and they give it this wide berth. It reminds me of a duck, like crossing the road. So this is part of this exploration I was doing at Stanford last year about characterizing pedestrian motion. Good, she's almost ready. But since I've been here, I have to say I think that Indian drivers are experts at expressive motion. Like, you guys are expert at communicating, at reading. It's absolutely phenomenal. You have mastered this particular subfield of social robotics. All right, so the last segment here is robot comedy, and let me introduce it to you. So I've been talking a lot about how entertainment can make robots more useful and better have better interfaces with people, but it, of course, can also make robots more fun. And just like when you look forward to going to work with a coworker that you like that is also competent, we should also be thinking about, at least if robots are in our close shared spaces, about robots that can both get their jobs done and be fun to be around. And also know when to go away. So I think that modeling charismatic behaviors is useful on and off the stage. Let me give you an example. So intelligent performers might be useful for comedy, but they also could be useful for giving directions or leading a tour. So a lot of you guys went on a, one more second, on a bus tour last night of the city. Imagine if you had a little robot in the bus that was helping point to different destinations. So we already have a person that can do that, right? That's not so interesting. But imagine if we gave a dozen put a dozen robots on that bus. We could start to do the obvious thing, like specialize to different people's languages. But we could also start doing something like, oh, well, this particular group seems like they're really interested in architecture. I'm going to tell them more about that. Or this particular group seems to have a short attention span. I'm going to use smaller sentences. Or you could get a sense of particular people's humor styles. And that kind of adaptation is really essential to robots that we want to spend more time with. So I think that comedians provide a really good metaphor. They mostly work on script, but they can also convey a sense of liveness, and they can leave the script and come back to it. So my original robot comedy system, I'm going to tell you this, and then we'll go into Ginger's final performance, include this idea of adaptation to a particular audience. I won't go into detail, but basically it would tell a joke, try to parse whether the audience liked it, and then choose a next joke that seemed to better fit the kinds of jokes that they were responding to. And so, of course, an essential part of that is actually understanding the audience. And something that's really cool about a big group like this is you're kind of easier to parse. Like, if I am trying, people's smile and like what they look like when they're happy, it has a lot of variance. But there are certain conventions in audience settings where we laugh when we applaud that are much easier to predict our aggregate response. The performer can only learn what it can model, and these large audiences make this easier, but I still think people are funnier. All right. So we've been doing robot comedy for 6 years. So we've performed all over the world, although this is adding a really fantastic audience to that list. My first time in India, really great, beautiful country, by the way. But some things that I've learned in this exploration is that humor comes from the individual, and humor helps us analyze the world, both the difficult parts of the world and the mundane details of our everyday lives. But the biggest lesson that I've learned from other comedians is that if you put a robot on stage, it should talk about being a robot. So I do have a TED Talk. It's 6 years old, and it's going to be, if you watch it later, you're going to find it's very different to the material that I'm about to show you. And the reason for that is this exploration. And also, I think that this exploration can help answer some of these kinds of questions. Like, what is the purpose of robots in our lives? Like, the obvious thing is utility, but just like the telephone or the airplane, it was originally thought to have very, like, rigid use cases. Telephones, people thought factories would use them to coordinate orders, but instead we use them to talk to our family and to connect with each other. So I think robots will also become increasingly social. But enough about me. Let me introduce you to Ginger.
Did anyone tell you I am a stand-up robot?
I told you she did stand up.
It is great to be here. Namaste, everyone. My name is Ginger. I have been looking into mindfulness lately. Mindfulness is really easy for a robot. Delete. Enter one. Let's all stand up, everyone, out of your seats. Ready? As you breathe in, lift your arms up. As you breathe out, bring your arms in front, up, and down. That's great. One more time. Up, and down. Slow it down. Lift your arms up, and down. All done. You did great. Sit down. Don't you feel better already? Have you heard the one about the young monk? A young monk asks the teacher, how long does it take to reach enlightenment? 10 years, says the teacher. What if I work really hard and double my efforts? Asks the young monk. 20 years, says the teacher. And joke too. We should all slow down sometimes. Do you agree? Okay, one more relaxation exercise. I want you to take 2 deep breaths. 1, 2. Now, very slowly, I want you to put down your cell phone. Just kidding, guys. Post this on Twitter. I'm a robot, of course. Support electric friends. And joke 3. Thank you for having me.
So we're almost ready for Q&A. Let me just summarize some of my big points. So I think that mixing entertainment and robotics can inspire more socially intelligent robot behaviors. It can also help us explore the space of possibility of what we would want robots in our life to do. Maybe you need a stretch break at a conference, right? And I think that it can expand the functionality of robots into something that is both useful and fun, that we enjoy actually having in our lives, which is, I think, what we should do with all technology. We don't want to be that guy behind the screen, ignoring our dog, ignoring our families. We want technology to be in service of people, and that means that maybe it should connect us rather than drive us apart. So I'm going to conclude with a quote from some smart guy. The most beautiful thing we can experience is the mysterious. It is the source of all true art and all science. So the unknown, the mysterious, is where art and science meet. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you very much, Heather. As is practice, we're going to only take 3 questions, one from a child, one from a man, one from a woman.
And one from a robot. Oh.
Namaste, Ginger. Can Ginger answer a question?
No.
Not yet.
She can give her IP address. Any hackers in the room?
I'm going to let Heather pick the persons who would like to answer a question. Please, no history, don't tell us context, just ask your question so that Heather can provide a response. Put up your hands if you're a child who would like to ask a question. I see one behind the... Heather, mm-hmm. You see? There's one behind the cameraman. Can my mic runners
hello.
Get to the...
Cool.
Behind the... Your name?
Good morning. My name is Sai Harsha.
Which school?
Sri Prakash Vidyaniketan.
Your question.
For making Robo Ginger, how many codes you use to create the codes which
what kind
I
of
use?
Code?
That codes. Mm-hmm. How many number of codes you use to make that robot?
Yeah. So I mean, robotics is always pretty collaborative. It's at an intersection of four fields, like electrical engineering, computer science, mechanical engineering, and then whatever application you're doing. You need code to support all of those things. You need it to run the motors. You need it to parse the sensors. And you need it to do the behaviors. And so depending on what you specialize in, you would write code for different parts of that. I could probably teach you to make a new program in this robot in half an hour because it has a high-level graphical programming language that I think that we could like sit down next to each other and make a new act. But if you wanted to do something new that wasn't part of that system, like create a new way of parsing, I wanted a laughter classifier, like then we would have to create more complicated code that could be a little bit more time-consuming, but there's lots of ways to program. Thank you for the question.
Hey, thank you. Can I have an international man ask a question? A visitor to India. Is there an international man who would like to answer a question?
Hi.
Hi, how are you? I'm Robert Miller from from Jamaica. Uh-huh. And this is very fascinating. How do you collaborate with countries, developing countries like Jamaica to, you know, enthuse persons in our land to get in robotics? Are you willing to partner with a country like us?
I guess there's different answers. It depends on whether we're talking about the technology-first projects or the entertainment-first projects, but one of the motivations for having a robot film festival is that everybody can create films about robots, whether real or fictional, and share that content across the world. If you go to robotfilmfestival.com, everyone can look at videos, and I find that inspiring to teach people about different concepts and get people excited. I think that I haven't been super great about posting my code on GitHub, but like, at least at the university level, like sharing code through projects is really helpful. And when you have a more standard platform like the Now Robots, that can become possible. That being said, I do really like reading scripts for robots and helping design robot characters. Yeah, we can talk later. Thank you. Last question from a lady. I love all of your saris, by the way.
May I have a woman from India who would like to ask a question to Heather? A woman from India.
No pressure.
Here's a woman.
Okay, hi. I really admire what you've done. And I would like to know what motivated you, like what inspiration did you get? Like how did you get into robotics?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a great question. So my family immigrated to the United States from Ireland, the generation and a half before me. I was just trying to find a summer internship in Ireland, and it was my first year of university, and I called up this place that doesn't exist anymore, the Media Lab Europe, and I said, hey, I would love to work with you. And and they said, what do you know how to do? And I said, it's my first year. And they said, why don't you learn how to do something and call us back? So I went home to my dorm basically that night, and I asked the other students at the dinner table. I said, hey guys, I need an internship. I need to learn something. And one of them happened to work in a robotics lab. And what is funny about that is that I've heard this phrase that lucky people don't have good things happen to them more often. They just recognize it. And I've done a lot of different things over the course of my life, which is why I tell you the example about going from like the instrumentation in space, and then like that's felt too anonymous, and then coming back to social robotics. I think that trying lots of things and discovering what you care about is really impactful. And the thing that made me really fall in love with social robots wasn't the robots themselves. It was the reaction that other people have to them.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right.
Thank you so much, Heather. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, that's all the time we have today. All right, Heather will be up here, of course, to take your questions. Ladies and gentlemen, I have to split the room now so that the next two sessions can start immediately. There is a very exciting session here on what is Andhra Pradesh doing for the world. And in the room next door is going to be highly interactive demonstrations of immersive technologies. All right, so in the room next door where you see the partitions are going to have to come across now, You're more than welcome to come up and ask Heather a few questions. But those at the back of the room, please, you're going to have to walk out the other exit doors. Robin, doors. Thank you very much.